Thank you, Mr. Arnold, our platinum sponsor. Thank you, Anthony. Our next topic is continuous training for safe helicopter operation by Captain Patrice Berdemas. Captain Patrice, over to you. The floor is yours, sir.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Captain Patrice Bredemus. I'm with you from Johor Bahru. First of all, thank you for inviting me at this Malaysian Virtual Safety Forum. It's really a pleasure as an operator to be invited and to talk about safety, and especially in this case, to talk about continuous training for safe operation. I prepared a small PowerPoint presentation to, let's say, try to discuss and to bring, I would say, the debate from, let's say, a theoretical approach to a practical approach. And I will try to concentrate my my speech on talking about training. How can training help us to make sure that we stop to have accident, and if we don't stop, at least we minimize the risk. Continuous training or recurrent training for safe operation. I will come back a bit quickly on who I am and what we are doing here. Then after we can start. Okay, I am head of training at Elang Flying Academy. Elang Flying Academy is an ATO, an approved training organization, flight training organization approved by the Civil Aviation Authority. We are located in Johor Bahru. So I think we, with all my team, we have quite a good expertise in terms of training. Okay, so the point is not to show you that I have a lot of experience in aviation. It's just to tell you that I think I am in a good position to try to talk about training. Let's talk about now. First, I would like to show you two definitions about what is recurrent training. One is the FAA definition, and the other one is extract also from the CM, okay? And you can see that it's quite clear. If you summarize the first one, recurrent training is a form of scheduled refresher training, okay, with a regular basis, okay? Training may be conducted in person with actual flight, or it can be simulated with a practical. At the end, what does it mean? It means that base system in place, okay, base things that need to be done to make sure that the pilots and the crew are well trained and maintain their competency and they are quite capable to fly the aircraft. That's a theoretical definition about training. Okay, if you come back about training, I would like to let's say to categorize in three different parts. Every pilot starts with his initial training. Initial training is what we say it will be the foundation. This is where you start. This is where you've been trained. You get your qualification, PPL, CPL, ATPL, or whatever license. Then you think you're a pilot, you've been well trained. So on the coming, on the start of your career, everything goes well. Then if you are lucky and if you can, okay, you have advanced training that can be, let's say, instrument rating or night vision goggles or advanced training. You go from a CPL, you extend to an ATPL. This can be done directly after the initial training or later on. Sometimes this part, advanced training, disappear. We have some people with initial training and they stop there. Okay, so luckily, some people, they can go from initial training to advanced training. Like I said, you have some extra rating on your license. Then comes the recurrent training, and we always forget this part, okay? Everybody thinks it's like driving a car. You drive your car, you learn how to drive your car 20 years ago, and you keep driving your car as it is. But you fly, you drive your car every day. So it is like a recurrent training, okay? Except if an emergency and something occurs. So really, I think this recurrent training or continuous training, like mentioned on the title of this presentation, is our core business, is the most important part for the pilot. I know it's quite difficult sometimes for the operator to understand the benefit of the recurrent training when it comes to cost. I will talk about this later on. Recurrent training, okay, how can we do some recurrent training and minimize, let's say, the cost and try to be effective? three possibilities, I mean, three parts of the ground training. The first one would be the ground training. Okay, there's a lot of things that can be done on the ground to prepare our pilots, especially right now with the pandemic. Okay, a lot of pilots, they stay on the ground, they have nothing to do, they can just maintain their qualifications, so they're not really, they can be a little bit rusted. So on the ground, there's also simulation and there's the flight. On the ground, what can be done? Okay, of course, like you organized today, meeting, online meetings, lectures, standardization workshop. And I think this ground part, okay, sometimes it's totally, it's not there anymore. Okay, in some companies, ATO, FTOs, or MAOC, or big companies, they minimize this aspect, okay? You can have a workshop to talk about a new way to escape the vortex ring on helicopter. At the end of the day, it doesn't cost a lot, it doesn't cost anything, and it can help people to maybe improve their knowledge. So ground training is one part, really easy to do. Simulation, of course, those days is going to be difficult to pick an Agusta 139 to fly 2 hours with two pilots just to continue their training, to be current, like we say, and to improve their knowledge and to revise. Okay, I fully understand this. It's like you take an Apache or a Tiger and you go and fly. Cost per hour would be crazy. So those days we develop a lot of solution in CBT, computer-based training, or flight training, synthetic device, simulators, basically. I really think that's enough, but I'm not going to say it's the future. It will not replace totally the flight, but it's a good transition from ground to flight. Simulation, I think, on the recurrent training need to be addressed all the time. Regarding the flight, okay, of course, as an operator, most of the time, flight equal operation equal money. Okay, you need to be paid to do something. But we always forget that our captain, our pilots, they need to be trained. Sometimes you haven't flown for years, okay, in IMC condition, or you haven't done any specific emergency, hydraulic failure, auto rotation, and an incident, something occurred, and your reflex, you're rusted, you're gonna have a small delay to react. Helicopter compared to fixed wing, okay, it's a reaction. There's not a lot of time to react, but unfortunately, for most of the emergencies. So training, then standardization. Why standardization? Because you want, okay, to keep the same, standard in your operation. You want all the pilots to apply the same technique, the same checklist, to make sure that everything has been standardized. The good point when you come to the professional side is that we have annual checks with OPC, LPC, to make sure that everybody has been checked. In Malaysia, it's well explained on the FOD. So my point is, a recurrent training is there. Most of the operator, okay, they have the tendency, unfortunately, to take it as the last part. So in terms of safety, when we talk about safety in a book, this approach will lead you on something which is on the paper, okay, it's SMS, yes, but SMS implementation, SMS, what we are doing on a daily basis to make sure that our pilots are safe, safely trained to fly. Safe operation, I'm gonna put some keywords on the board, on the slide, just to as a guideline, to make sure that I cover all the different aspects, and I'm sure after that you will have a lot of questions. As a training organization, it's clear that for us, okay, our school established in Johor Bahru, we have procedure, we are highly qualified pilots, we have helicopters, we have simulator, and our day-to-day operation is to train the pilot, is to make sure that our students are well trained on the foundation, on the initial part. Then after they go to the operators, but they forget sometimes to come back to do some recurrent training. So safety. Okay, since the beginning, okay, all the speakers, they've been through all the different parts of the safety. Safety in this case and risk. Risk assessment based on what? Based on the capacity of the students. Sorry, I say students because I'm a training organization, but based on the pilot to react in case of emergency. At the end of the day, each operator, yes, will have the tendency to say my aircraft is insured. So, okay, I'm going to crash the aircraft. That's a risk. I have an insurance, I can pay, but if someone inside the aircraft is injured or there is fatality, then it's not the same story, okay? What the recurrent training will come in the middle, okay, to help you to minimize the risk and to increase the safety. I'm sure about this, there is no doubt about this. Expertise, of course, a pilot with 10,000 hours, you're going to say to me, he's a good pilot, he's an expert on what he's doing. Yes, he's an expert on what he's doing. But what's going to happen if something is not, it's something new for him or something that he used to do 20 years ago? Okay, I hope you get my point on this one. I'm not saying that a guy with 10,000 hours is not good. I'm saying that a guy with 10,000 hours maybe forget something that he learned 30 years ago or 20 years ago. So expertise will, so recurrent training, the training, basically the training on the simulator, okay, on the flight will help you to keep this expertise and to be confident. Okay, confidence inside the aircraft. When something goes wrong, we all know things go very quickly. In helicopter world, okay, it's even faster. The time to react in case of an engine failure on a single engine aircraft, in helicopter, is 1 or 2 seconds, okay, to lower the collective pitch. So if you don't practice auto-rotation at all, okay, you stay for years, okay, because you are flying, for example, on a twin engine helicopter, and then suddenly you come back on a single engine and you have an engine failure or an engine fire. What will be your time? So to be confident, you need to make sure that when you are flying, you receive, let's say, the good training and the required training to achieve and to fly safely and confident. Stress, of course, we are all under stress, okay? This operation, our top boss, our management will ask you to fly a lot, to each 1 hour is money, 1 hour need to, so yes, there's a stress, okay? It creates a stress. And if you start to take off because there's a bad weather condition, you haven't flown in IMC for a while, you are not sure about the system, it's a new aircraft, you stay 6 months on the ground, a lot of stress because of the COVID-19, you've been grounded for some time. And really, this is one of the factors that the recurrent training can minimize. It can help you to reduce the stress. The stress will be there always. Fatigue. Of course, there's a fatigue on board, there's a fatigue, but the fatigue is directly linked with the stress. I really think that someone who is well-trained, happy to fly, no stress, and is taking the time, some time for him, okay, to improve for himself, to learn something new, okay, the stress and the fatigue will go down. Last 2 points, quality, and I put this with cost. Of course, as an operator with an AOC on the helicopter, on like a fixed wing, it's always the same. It is quite difficult these days with a very advanced helicopter or very advanced airplane to accept to give an aircraft for 2 hours just for training to do a circuit or to do emergency. I fully understand this, but you don't have to do your auto rotation on the 139 simulator. You can do it on whatever, on single engine aircraft, which is cheaper. On the R66, on the EC120, on the Bell 206, it will reduce the cost and it will increase the quality of your, let's say, the service you can provide. Okay, so all of these points, if I may say, will help you. Okay, the title of my presentation. Okay, which I tried to take it on the practical side. It's really continuous training, recurrent training for everybody, for PPL, for CPL, for NATPL. Okay, you have some PPLs, let's say older, who stay years without having training. They just fly from point A to point B with an aircraft with no idea what's going to happen in case of emergency. I really think this is where we need to look up. For sure, some big oil and gas operator, they have a dedicated training department. They have training captain. They already put everything in place. But we need to go through all of these, let's say, operators of helicopter. I tried to go through all the different points. Before I hand over to Miss Ida, I just would like to say one thing, okay? I've been flying for a couple of years, and I really think that I heard too many times, okay, training is gonna cost me money. We have the tendency when things goes wrong and we want to make money, some companies, they have the tendency to remove the training because they think, oh, the guy is well experienced, he's well qualified, no doubt he can achieve his mission, he doesn't need to fly. Okay, he can fly without and close his eyes. But unfortunately, when we do some investigation on some of accident or incident, it appears that the guy was unable or not capable to react, okay, on an emergency, on a very stressful situation, something new, or but he did, but so long time ago. So I really think I encourage the operators to look at it, okay? Yes, it costs a little bit, the simulation to reduce the cost, yes, It is something for the company, but at the end, it's a safety, and your crew will also appreciate the fact that you put some effort to let them fly well trained, well standardized, well qualified, and ready to fly in a good, let's say, easy. So I will be happy to answer any question if there is some. I will handle. I will pass back to Ms. Ida. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Captain Patrice. Ladies and gentlemen, today we learned that the continuous training is so very important. Thank you again, Captain. And now let's take one question. Yes, Captain, whenever you are ready.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm back. A very good question, because yes, I have I forget one in my brief. I was talking only about pilots, okay? And the question is very clear. When we talk about initial advanced and recurrent training are synonymous with air crew, but not necessary for other people in aviation. Do you think it would be good to make recurrent training as mandatory for all aviation personnel? Definitely. Okay, I concentrate my speech on the flying part. But for sure, the crew member or the ground crew, the maintenance are definitely part. Okay, it's the same if let's say an engineer stay for years, okay, without any recurrent training, is a B13 qualified, he can do the inspection, he can release the aircraft, but no training, nothing for 20 or 30 years. Okay, what was valid 30 years ago is not valid anymore. So for sure, definitely, there's no doubt about this. When we talk about initial training, advanced training, and recurrent training, we talk about all the people involved in aviation business, from the ground crew. It's the same for air traffic controller. It's the same for, let's say, all the people who are, let's say, around the aircraft, inside the aircraft, and taking care of the aircraft. Definitely, definitely a valid point. And I hope that my speech will help people to consider that the training is not the last part of the process. It's maybe the most important part. Your initial training, how you've been trained, will give you all the chance to start your career. But if after they stop to train you, you get old and things are not so good. Thank you very much for your time. And
thank you very much, Captain Patrice. We really appreciate that.